guys, welcome back to the My Miller Show. So today is a really important day. I wanted to invite Bill here. He is an inspector, and I wanted to invite Bill on the show to talk about why it is so important to get a home inspection, whether you are buying or just selling a home, and why should you get a home inspection. So I have Bill here. Thank you, Bill, for coming in today. Can I have you introduce yourself?
Yes, thank you for having me. My name is Bill Bisick. I'm with Inspect at First out of Andover. I've been doing home inspections since 2010, back during the REO days. Mm-hmm. And I started out inspecting for banks.
Wow, you've been in the business for a long time.
I've seen it all. I've seen it all.
So why is it so important, Bill, to get a home inspection, whether you're buying a house or selling a house?
Well, for the buyers, it's going to be one of the most important purchases of your life. And you want to make sure that the house is safe, that there's not going to be any real major expenses that you need to incur. Shortly after you purchase the house, talking structural, sometimes the roof, even mechanical sometimes can be expensive, you know, and that's something that I talk with the clients about. But my main purpose of the inspection is not only just to point out defects of the house, but kind of to create a honey-do list for the buyer. Mm-hmm. You know, this is something you're not going to ask the seller to do.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. Because your job is to create this long list of inspection stuff, right? So yep. That's your job.
Yep. My inspection mm-hmm. report's generally, mm-hmm. you know, 40 to 60 pages long. Mm-hmm. You know, so
that's longer than an essay I've ever written in my entire life.
it's fairly detailed. Mm-hmm. But then I think, you know, the most important part of the inspection is I like to educate the client as to how their house works. Maintenance stuff that they need to take care of on a monthly basis or on a regular basis, biannually or annually, whatever the case might be. And then also ways that they can protect themselves from that unforeseen expense that might be coming, because there are a few different ways that you can protect yourself.
What are some unforeseen stuff that you think that we should at an inspection that we normally look out for?
Well, the main stuff that I see is with your mechanicals. Mm-hmm. You know, you've got a 20-year-old furnace.
Right.
You could have only a 15-year-old air conditioner, which is something that we see all the time, but it uses what they call the R22 Freon. Mm-hmm. They don't make that anymore.
Right.
So, you know, you're going to have to plan on mm-hmm. at some point here in the future. Minnesota air conditioners run forever.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Never get to use them. But sooner and later, you're going to have to replace that. Mm-hmm. You know, same thing with the water heater. But there's ways to protect yourself with that, either through a home warranty. Or I prefer a program through Conexus Energy or CenterPoint Energy. It's called Home Service Plus, where you just pay extra money on your gas bill every month. And then if something breaks down, they come out and fix it.
Wow, yeah. Yeah. What are some big items that are normally, like furnaces, right? They're big ticket items. Roof are big ticket items.
Roof, yes.
Minnesota, because a lot of our homes are built underground or under the soil. Beneath the soil, it's like, you know, water seepage is a huge issue in Minnesota. You know, and it becomes a mold issue, right? Mm-hmm. And you do inspections for mold as well.
We do mold testing and asbestos testing as well. Mm-hmm. Along with your older houses, especially here in St. Paul. I always recommend a sewer scope. Another interesting thing that we find in a lot of the St. Paul homes are lead pipes, where the water line coming into
right.
the house is lead.
They're going away from that PVC now, right?
Yep. So that's all changing. But if I understand it correctly, St. Paul has a grant where they're actually going to start replacing all the lead piping.
Wow. that's great.
Without no cost to the homeowner. Now, don't call me, you know, quote me on that.
Yeah.
But that's what I've heard, okay. that's where they're going.
Wow.
With that. So that's a good thing.
Yeah, there's a lot of good resources out there for homeowners too. Yeah.
Absolutely.
So, you know, one thing that I really want to talk about with you today too is also radon, right? Because radon is an odorless, tasteless gas.
Mm-hmm.
And if not tested, you won't ever know it's there. And long-term exposure can cause cancer, right? So you do that kind of testing.
We do radon testing. I recommend it 100% of the time. It's, and what radon gas is, it, like you said, it's, you can't smell it. You know, you don't know it's there, but it comes from the decomposition of uranium in the soil. Mm-hmm. So when they build your house, they dig the foundation or pour a slab over the earth that containing the gas, mm-hmm. and then it'll find a crack in a wall, get into the house. And anything over 4.0 picocuries per liter, it's recommended to get a mitigation system put in. The state of Minnesota Department of Health actually recommends considering it between 2 and 4. Mm-hmm. But the real estate threshold is at 4.0.
Wow.
So if you're at 3.9, no, you don't need it. 4.0, you do, which I think is a bunch of hooyah.
Right, yeah. Close enough.
But
we're not quite there yet.
It is the number one cause of lung cancer for non-smokers. So it is a serious issue.
It is, yeah. And not a lot of homeowners know that, hey, there's extra things, because a lot of buyers, right, in the market, they're thinking, oh, we're just going to do a home inspection, it's going to cover everything. But no, you have to do radon and mold if you want to do it. Sewer scope, they're additional, they're different from just doing a traditional home inspection.
Yes.
Right. So that's where you come and play, where you offer everything in the books to do a home inspection on top of just conducting a home inspection alone.
Yeah, we can offer pretty much everything that you would want. If the house has a wood-burning fireplace, we offer level 2 chimney inspections, where we actually run a camera up and down the flue of the chimney, looking for cracks, any damages inside the flue that you're not going to normally see on an inspection itself. You know, we'll inspect it from the top and from the bottom, but it's all that middle part that doesn't get seen, so then we'll need a camera for that.
Right.
We also offer stucco inspections, mm-hmm. You know, and that's where your water intrusion is coming into the exterior of the home and is getting trapped behind the stucco, which can be a problem. We do offer mold and asbestos mm-hmm. Testing. Mm-hmm. Plus we do new build inspections and pre-drywall inspections.
On new constructions.
On new construction.
Nice, yeah.
So everyone thinks, well, I'm buying a new home, why do I need to have an inspection? Well, I just did a new build inspection yesterday and I had 12 items that the builder will be taking care of that got missed.
That's
because
great.
You know, we're all human, mm-hmm. we make mistakes and stuff gets missed. So,
exactly. So
the new build and the pre-drywall mm-hmm. are just as important as any other inspection.
Yeah, I think that doing an inspection will just save the buyer, the new homeowner, a lot of like just headaches or just preventing future issues in the future. Let's say if you detect it, we can get it figured out today. For example, a chimney, fireplace, fires are one of the, like we talked yesterday, one of the number one fires in Minnesota. So, you know, in a way to prevent that is to get your chimney inspected annually, right?
Actually, every year, if you're going to be, you know, burning wood or coal, you know, whatever the case might be in a fireplace, that should be cleaned, swept, and inspected on an annual basis.
Yeah, nice. So let's talk a little bit about asbestos.
Okay.
So asbestos, we found it a lot in older homes, right?
Yeah.
And, you know, maybe some of our viewers may not know asbestos is. Can we touch a little bit about asbestos and how we test for it and how dangerous it is?
Well, asbestos is a carcinogen that can cause many different types of cancer. No, I'm not a doctor, so I,
right.
you know, I don't know where. But back in the day, everything that was made had asbestos. Plastic had it. Tiles had it. You know, so many different things that we see in older houses have asbestos. Well, that in and of itself is not alarming because it doesn't really affect you until you start, if you got tile on the floor and you start scraping it up and now you're breathing that, or you're taking down ceiling tiles that have it, you know, or old sheetrock or plaster that might have it, had it. So if it just stays as it is, that's really not a big issue, okay? It's when you start tearing it up. You know, so if you got tile on your floor and you don't like it, you can always cover over it, and you're not gonna hurt anything. So there's really only one issue, you know, if the people aren't planning on doing any remodeling, that I have with asbestos, and that's it's called vermiculite in attic insulation, or wall insulation as well. And technically it's zonolite. And that's an insulation that's full of asbestos that we typically find in the attic. And that stuff gets airborne very easy. So whenever I see that, I recommend getting it tested. Make sure you see if it does have asbestos. The good thing about that is that there was a class action lawsuit many years ago, because this actual zonolite came from mines in Montana. They discovered that it was contaminated, and so they created this class action lawsuit. So if you do have it, you can apply for a grant where you can get money to have someone remove it and then re-insulate your attic with. But you see it a lot on like the story and a halfs, you know, and that's, you know, because everybody wants to put that, you know, third bedroom up there on the story and a half. Okay, well, you know, you got to deal with this first. Okay,
exactly.
But it can be dealt with, you know. So
it just has to with that asbestos, so you know, it has to be dealt with professionally, right? You have to have a professional team come in, and they have to encapsulate it, they have to properly mitigate it. So
it's a pretty extensive process to do that, but that's not something you want. It's not a DIY project.
Yeah, that's something out of my expertise for sure.
Right.
Yeah. So with home inspections, not only buyers should do home inspections, but a lot of sellers should do them as well. And you've done a lot of seller inspections for pre-inspections, right?
But it's what they call them is pre-listing inspections. I do quite a few of those. And there's a lot of advantages to doing a pre-listing inspection. You know, some real estate agents hate them because now you're putting everything out there. Okay, and they're going, well, we don't want to have to fix this or fix that. You're just gumming things up, mucking everything all up. So they kind of really push back at me about it. But there are advantages to doing it, and especially during the time period that we just came through, where 60% of the home buyers didn't get a home inspection. Okay, so now you're trusting that home seller to disclose everything that was wrong with that house. Well, they don't always do that.
Right.
Okay, so if you get a pre-listing inspection, you don't have to worry about disclosing anything, saying, here's the report, we're not fixing anything, but here's the problems with the house. Or here's the report, we took care of this, this, and this. Maybe FHA required repairs that needed to be done. And we took care of this, this, and this, but this is the other stuff you need to be concerned about. So it actually helps the whole process go along smoother. It makes the buyer feel more comfortable about buying a house, especially first-time home buyers. They get real anxious and nervous and, you know, what's my house like?
Right.
Is it safe? Well, now they got it right in front of them. So there's a lot of advantages to that. You know, so I recommend that. The other thing I recommend is all those people that bought a house, all your audience out there that bought a house without an inspection, you can still do it now.
Okay, so it's not too late.
No, because what I'm gonna do is what I do on every inspection. I'm gonna point out to you stuff you need to be concerned about. I'm gonna make you that honey-do list, okay? I'm gonna talk to you about safety items. I'm gonna talk to you about maintenance. I'm gonna teach you about your house. You know, tell you, you know, what your timeline is, how much longer could you have to plan on for your furnace or your air conditioner, water heater, or your roof. Look at your basement to see if there's something that really should be done now or if it's something you should watch. You know, if we got some buckling walls or bowing walls, you know, that's showing, you know, water pressure pushing in on the wall, that could be, you know, a possibly severe problem that if we took care of now, we're going to avoid a bigger problem in the future.
Right.
So I'm starting to get a lot of calls for that. You know, all these people that didn't get the home inspection.
Right.
You know, they would say, I just want to learn about my house. I go, yeah. Well, you called the right guy.
You're perfect for it.
You know, and then the other thing is I'll do a walkthrough with a seller, just showing them stuff that they should do to prepare to sell their house. You know, outlet covers, loose wires, you know, loose light fixtures. You know, just stuff that you should really, because it's going to come up in the report. Mm-hmm. Let's do it now. Then you don't have to worry about it
exactly.
later.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah, that's a really good, I mean, especially in a market like today, when it becomes a seller's market, you're able to provide that disclosure to the buyers. And to save time, they don't have to conduct their own inspection. They can look, they have the report in front of them, and they can just decide whether or not they want to pursue the property.
Yeah.
Right? So.
Yeah.
That is a, you know, that's a really good thing. And I've have a few of my sellers that's done pre-listing inspections before putting the home on the market, and it just saves everybody so much time.
Oh yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. It's, to me, it's a no-brainer.
Yeah.
But I do get a lot of pushback from the real mm-hmm. estate community, mm-hmm. saying, "Why in the world would we do that?" Mm-hmm. You know, like there's benefits to this, mm-hmm. you know.
Yeah.
But they don't care to listen, so.
Yeah. How long does it take you to do a full inspection?
So the average inspection takes me 3 hours, and that's from top to the bottom, you know,
Okay. From
the top of the roof for a chimney to the bottom of the sump basin in the basement, includes all mechanicals, all the plumbing, every component of the house, simple things is making sure the door is open and closed properly.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know?
I mean, you're probably very thorough to be able to do that. You know, I mean, 3 hours is a long time to do an inspection because you have to climb on the roof. You have to make sure, like you said, all the smallest things that we could ever see with our naked eye. We might not be able to. You do it all. And, you know, those automatic closes on the garage door, they're so important, right? Or just making sure the eyes are meeting so that the garage door can close, stuff like that, it's very detail oriented.
Yep. Especially the auto reverse on the garage door.
Mm-hmm.
Those fail 9 times out of 10.
Oh yeah.
Nobody knows what they are.
Mm-hmm.
That's something else that I do is I teach the homeowner. Mm-hmm. Says most garages have a sticker on it. Mm-hmm. Said recommended to do this test every month.
Mm.
And I point that out to them.
You know, I can guarantee you that most of the people I know, they don't do that.
I don't think anybody does. And, but it's a say it's an important safety issue.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we don't
especially
want the garage door
kids.
Crushing kids
yeah.
or dogs or mm-hmm. cats or any, you know, anything. It needs to, when it touches something, it needs to stop and then automatically come back up. Mm-hmm. But so after I spend the hours in the house, you know, typically on my own, then I always schedule an hour to do the walkthrough and a review with the client. And then we go through everything, you know, I write down all my notes and we go through everything that I've seen and we talk about it. We talk about all the maintenance stuff. And I tell you what, every one of my clients, when they leave the inspection, are relieved.
Mm-hmm. Because they've done a home inspection.
Yeah, and they're so nervous when they get there. Mm-hmm. And I'm going, you got nothing to be nervous about. Mm-hmm. As I do this every single day, you know, a couple times a day, many days. And you know, I'm not here to crush your dreams, because by the time they call me, they've fallen in love with that house. Mm-hmm. I'm here to educate you.
Right. Yeah. I mean, what I love about it too, is you not only do the home inspection, you also walk them through the house, and you also show them how to, you know, this is how your house works, right? How to change a filter, right? Because Not a lot of homeowners, I can tell you, don't know how to change their filter. They don't get done quick enough. You're supposed to do it, what, once every couple months?
Every month, I recommend, with the 1-inch, and just use the cheapest. Go to Menards and buy a case, get 12 of them, mm-hmm. of the cheapest filters that they have, and change that every month.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, you buy the thick, expensive ones, they restrict the air, they actually make the furnace work harder.
Oh, wow, that's good to know.
So you're further ahead just by the cheapest ones that are out
okay.
there.
Okay, so the most expensive one isn't always the best ones either.
No. Okay. You know, you can get into some that are 3 inches wide or 4 inches wide. Mm-hmm. Well, those can go a few months, mm-hmm. you know, between changes. But typically with the 1-inch, I always recommend once a month.
Wow, yeah, that's good to know.
So it's just a matter of remembering.
Right.
I always like to tell the guy in the relationship to pick his wife's birthday. Mm. That way you're not going to forget her birthday.
That's a good point.
And then I tell him, I says, and buy her a case of them for her birthday. What better birthday present could
right,
you get her?
Exactly.
You know?
Yeah, that's a good one. I like that one.
So
you won't ever forget her birthday.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you know, and because I think one time I had a client, they called me. They're like, oh, we're not receiving air in the house. It's like, well, when was the last time you changed your furnace? Your mm-hmm. furnace filter, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, so that's so important.
The other thing I point out with the furnace, and most people, a lot of people don't know about, is that there's an electric switch mm-hmm. on the furnace or on the wall by the furnace that looks like a light switch.
Mm-hmm.
And they never get marked. So I point that out to them. I'm going, this, and I show them. I turn it off. I go, this will turn your furnace off
mm-hmm.
or your air conditioner, depending on what time of year.
Mm-hmm.
I go, and then you're going to call me and say, Bill, my furnace isn't working. And I'm going to tell you to turn it on.
Because save him a couple $100 of trip charge.
Right. Yeah, because most people don't know that there's an electric switch for their furnace.
Right. Yeah.
You know, and wow. I don't know why they don't make a better setup so they can't be turned. Well, they got to be able to be turned off, but so it's not so easy to turn them
mm-hmm.
off.
Or you have some kids playing around, they just like, you
kids
know.
Kids go, kids turn off. Switches off and on all the time.
Yeah, I used to do that when I was a kid. Like, it's just so fun to play with, right? But they don't know.
Right.
And then the parent calls you, oh, our furnace isn't working. We're not getting heat. Yeah. Wow. So, with the roof, because Minnesota, there's so much snow, right? With all that weight from the snow on the roof, mm-hmm. like, it's so important for you to also get on the roof, to go look at the roof. So what are some key components on a roof that when you look for?
It depends a lot on the age of the roof. Yesterday when I was doing this new build, there was one whole elevation that the shingles did not seal.
Mm-hmm.
So they were all loose. I could flip them up and down.
Wow.
Like this. So they did not seal properly.
Yeah. When it doesn't seal properly, water can get through it, right?
Right. Or they can blow right off. Mm-hmm. You know, a strong wind will blow them right off. The other thing I look for is damaged shingles, missing shingles. If they were installed properly or not, you know, if I can see nail heads, you know, they weren't lined up properly and they weren't installed properly. The flashing or the roof vents on the roof, to make sure they were installed properly. real common thing that we see are what they call exposed fasteners, the nails that are used to attach these. They'll forget to put a silicone over the top of them, so then they rust out. So now you got these holes in your roof.
Oh, yeah.
After the nail rusts away. Mm-hmm. Okay. People yeah. wondering, why am I getting a drip in my
right
in my attic? So yeah, there's a number of things up there, making sure the flashing was installed properly. We always look at the roof line as we come up to the property to see where the water's coming off of the roof.
Okay.
And especially with newer houses, these big two stories, mm-hmm. two story, 4,000 foot houses, they got so many gables on the front and all this water is being concentrated
right
into one area, which then leads to a foundation problem, mm-hmm. you know. So yeah. the roof is a very important component of the house.
I bet. Yeah, I've seen a lot of new constructions now. They, like you said, so many gables, but they don't have any gutters.
And they won't.
They won't put gutters on, no. Right? I mean,
I had this conversation here a few weeks ago with one of the construction superintendents for Lennar.
Mm.
And I'm going, you know, these people are paying $600,000, $700,000 for a house. Gutters are cheap. Why don't you put gutters on these places? Mm. You know, because they are important. I recommend it every time I see a house without gutters, put gutters on. And he told me what ended up happening was people wouldn't keep their gutters clean and they would clog, and then they'd call Lennar and blame them. So they just quit offering it. They don't even offer it as a package or nothing.
Wow. So if they want it, it's in an additional charge.
Not through Lennar. They have to do it themselves.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, Lennar won't install gutters.
So. Wow.
I thought that was kind of weird.
Yeah,
kind of interesting.
Interesting. I suppose it becomes a issue that they have to deal with after the fact, and they just like, oh, we just...
Yeah, they just don't want the headache.
Wow, that makes sense. I mean, with the gutters, too, you have to clean them every year, yeah. Right? After fall, you have all these leaves. They clog up your gutters. Water doesn't have any place to go, right?
Well, the best thing to do, and there's many things that you should do to prepare your house for the fall, for the winter months, but the gutters... Once all the leaves have fallen, mm-hmm. you want to get those cleared out this fall, not wait till spring.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Because they're going to hold all that rainwater and they're going to clog, and they're going to hold all that rainwater in there, and it's going to freeze. And as your snow's melting, and then that water could come back up underneath
sense.
The shingles.
Yeah, a lot of weight on your gutters in the winter.
Yeah.
That
so
makes sense.
To make sure you clean those out mm-hmm. in the fall after all the leaves have fallen,
yeah.
so it drains properly.
That's a good to-do list for the fall. So remember that, folks, clean your gutters.
Yeah.
So sump pumps, right? Minnesota, right now it's mandatory to install sump pumps in new constructions, right? But a lot of homes, you don't see sump pumps. So, a lot of my homeowners, when they have sump pumps, they don't realize that if your electricity goes out, your sump pump stops working, right? So let's talk about sump pump a little bit.
Well. And when I have a house with a sump pump, okay, and especially if it's got a high water table in the sump basin itself, the sump basin is dry and appears like it's never had a drop of water in it, I really don't go into the conversation with them. But if we are holding water, and you're right, when a storm comes in and heavy rain and the electricity goes out, that's when you need the sump pump.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now you have no electricity, you have no sump pump. I had a neighbor this past summer that it happened to, and their basement flooded.
Mm.
And so what I recommend, you can get it's a battery backup, just like it's a regular car battery, that you put right next to your sump basin and you connect it to the pump, so that if the electricity goes out, the battery kicks in.
You have your battery back on.
And your sump is gonna work. The other thing that's not a bad idea is to put an alarm on it. And with all these new smart home technologies, you know, you can hook everything to your phone.
Mm-hmm.
You know, your thermostat, you know, you put stuff on your plumbing that'll tell you if you have a pipe that broke.
Wow.
You know, it measures water flow.
Yeah. Wow.
But you can also do it with that alarm. So if you're out for the evening and all of a sudden the sump stops working and the water's rising, then this alarm will notify you, hey, you better get home because you have an issue with your sump.
Wow.
So yeah, that's very important. You hear these horror stories all the time. Mm-hmm. Well, I got a sump pump. Well, you need them when it's storms are coming.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And that's when they stop working.
Exactly.
So it's just an easy way to protect yourself. Mm-hmm.
Wow. Yeah. I've never thought about having a battery backup, but that's a great idea for homeowners.
Yeah.
So what areas do you cover for home inspections?
Oh, I'm pretty much all over. I'm located in Andover. Sunday I was up in Mille Lacs.
That's pretty far.
Okay. I've been as far as Mille Lacs. Mm-hmm. I actually have a cabin in Alexandria.
Mm.
So I'll do inspections up there.
Okay.
I love doing them up there. It gives me a reason to go to the cabin.
Right, spend a night.
You know, but typically anything, from the cities to St. Cloud.
Okay.
And then I go as far south as Apple Valley. I've been down to Owatonna. I do, the entire core of the city. And then east out to Stillwater, Lake Elmo, so I cover a pretty large area.
Yeah, that's pretty good. So you go pretty much everywhere within about 2 hours, 1.5 to 2 hours.
Yeah,
from the cities. Yeah, that's pretty good.
Yeah. With gas prices this summer, I had to kind of put a little surcharge on if I was going to have to travel too far. But I do a lot of going west, Hutchinson, St. Michael, Otsego, just Chaska, Carver, Shakopee, I'm pretty much all over.
Yeah, that's pretty good. Oh, one thing I wanted to touch base on is sewer scoping, because I know you did mention that you do sewer scope too.
Yep.
So why is it important to do sewer scope?
Well, it's a huge unseen. So your sewer drain comes out of the house, under the ground, in the basement, somewheres, or a slab on grade, then it just goes right down in the earth. And then it typically goes through your front yard and then hooks into the main sewer in the street. Mm-hmm. Okay. It's the homeowner's responsibility for that sewer line from where it hooks to the street to inside their house. Well, especially with older houses that either had clay sewer lines, cast iron sewer lines, galvanized pipe sewer lines, they can crush, they can leak, they can break. Tree roots can grow into them and clog them.
Mm-hmm.
So what we do is we run a camera from inside the house all the way out to where the sewer line hooks into the city sewer. And just like the chimney inspection, we're doing a visual. It's a camera. You get a video when you do it. Just, watching it go all the way down. That way we can tell what kind of pipe you got. We can tell if your pipes are starting to clog, that they need to be cleaned. Or in the worst case scenario, we can see if a pipe is broken and it's leaking water. If you ever see a street that all of a sudden has a big sinkhole in it.
Oh.
That typically from leaking water.
Wow.
It'll happen in your front yard.
Mm-hmm.
So then it's a matter of, or if it's crushed, then it's got to be replaced, or they do have sleeves that they can do it, but it's not any much cheaper. They have to dig up your entire front yard, not the entire yard, but a pretty good sized trench, and replace that. And the cost on that can run you anywhere from $10,000 to $12,000.
Yeah, could get pretty expensive, and getting an inspection like that done can save the buyer a lot of money and headache.
Well worth the investment.
Mm-hmm.
Well worth the investment,
And just to have a peace of mind, right?
Have the peace of mind.
Mm-hmm.
And then any recommendations that we give, it's, hey, you're going to, within a year, you're drains aren't going to be working properly, and you're going to need to get this cleaned. Mm-hmm. You know, yeah. This way you can be proactive, get it done ahead of time.
Yeah.
So it's not real common to see, you know, crushed or damaged sewer lines, but we certainly see enough of them to make it worth the while.
Yeah.
You know, and like you say, the peace of mind, mm-hmm. just knowing, okay, yeah.
Everything's good.
We're not going to have to deal with that, mm-hmm. but especially with older houses.
Right. Yeah. Do you deal a lot with sewer and septic and septic tanks and well?
I don't. So, you know, typically if a home has a septic system, private septic system, and a private water line, typically what happens is that the seller is responsible to have that septic inspected, mm-hmm. making sure it perks properly, and to have a water test done.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
I actually had a gal ask me yesterday if I'd come in and do a water test, and I said, I can do it for you. I don't specifically do it myself, but there's a company in Elk River that does it where we take the sample, but you could do it yourself too and save yourself a lot of money.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense.
You know,
yeah.
You know, you don't need any of my expertise to do this. You just fill a vial with water and you, mm-hmm. you mail it back to them. And, mm-hmm. and so,
yeah.
But yeah, typically those things are done by the seller, so I don't get involved
okay.
with that.
Yeah. Is there anything else you want to touch on that we haven't touched on yet?
Do we have time? You want to talk about fall maintenance?
Yes. Let's talk about fall. Fall's on the way. Winter's coming, right?
Yes.
So let's talk about some to-dos for fall to get ready for winter.
Yes.
Let's do that.
Okay. Well, number one thing I recommend is get your furnace serviced. Okay, have a professional HVAC technician come out, make sure that your furnace is working properly. You know, you're mixing gas and air and it's combusting, and you want to make sure that that's mixing properly and that your furnace is working properly. I recommend to all my clients to get your furnace serviced once a year. And where Home Service Plus comes in, that's a service that they offer at no charge. That's why I really kind of gravitate towards them. I'm not advocating for them. I don't got any money in the game with them. I love their service. I have it on my house. Change that furnace filter. Make sure you get that furnace filter changed. If you got an air exchanger in your home, clean your air exchanger. And actually, I had posted not too long ago, I did a YouTube video a few years back on how to clean the filters in an air exchanger, mm-hmm. which need to be done every 3 months, so
okay.
4 times a year.
Okay.
Okay. And you can see how it's done. It's on my personal Facebook page.
Okay.
And we should do one of those videos.
We should.
Nobody knows what they are.
Mm-hmm.
Change the batteries and test your smoke and CO detectors.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Yeah, those are so important, especially CO. It's also a tasteless, odorless.
Yep. And going into the winter, and if your furnace isn't burning properly, we hear stories every single year of families that have died from CO poisoning.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and it's just tragic because it doesn't need to happen.
Right. If they have that CO carbon
monoxide. CO detector in your house, there needs to be a CO detector on each level of the home, mm-hmm. and a CO detector within 10 feet of each bedroom.
Okay.
Then a smoke detector on each level of the home and in each bedroom.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And they recommend them hardwired now.
Hardwired, but if you're not hardwired, you can still get by with just a battery-operated one.
Mm-hmm.
But the battery's got to be changed. The fire marshal recommends that they get changed every twice a year. So every time you turn your clock, change the batteries in your smoke and your CO alarms. So imperative that's got to mm-hmm. make sure that gets done. If you're going to be burning wood in your chimney or in your fireplace, have the chimney inspected. Any exhaust ports that are coming out of the side of your house? So like with the condensing furnace, you know, you see these plastic pipes coming out of the house. You know, or your bath fans, you know, that'll exhaust out the side of your house. Your air exchanger will exhaust out the side and plus bring air in. But animals like during the summer to build their nests in these areas.
Yes.
Okay. So make sure they're all clear. Or bees that might have decided to make it their home. Don't do anything with your air conditioner. Air conditioners are built and made to stay outside in Minnesota. They don't need to be covered.
Okay.
You don't need to put a big board on top of it. Because what you're doing, if you cover it, now you're given a hiding space for little critters that like to come in and chew on wires.
That makes a lot of sense because I always cover my AC unit in the winter, right? So that makes it a good point.
You don't need to do that.
Okay.
It's not recommended at all by the AC manufacturer. But, you know, when you're looking at your AC, you got your refrigeration line going into the house through the sidewall, and or any other ports that are coming out of the house, they always wrap them, you know, seal them with silicone. Well, that silicone can start to deteriorate, and then now you got a little opening into the house for critters. So make sure all your ports around the house are all sealed and tight. So because this is when you want to come inside. You know, they want to get out of the cold.
Right.
Drain your exterior water lines. You know, turn off the valve on the inside and then go outside and open up that valve. And there is a little bleeder valve on the inside that if you open that up, that'll allow air to come through and push it through. But just make sure you tighten everything up so next spring, because you're not going to remember. You turn the water on, then you got water spraying all over the place. But that's important to do, and that's something I go through with during my inspection too with the homeowner.
Yeah, you know, they learn a lot with the house.
And then if you got a lawn irrigation system, that's got to be winterized. Okay, that's something you can do yourself if you've got the proper equipment. You need a big enough air compressor to do it, so it can be done. But generally, in the fall, you're going to see signs all over the place, you know, blowouts for $50 or $70, $75.
Right. It's worth the investment too.
Just to have someone else do it for you.
So
that's what I got, but to make sure, you know, let's get our house ready for bed in the fall.
Exactly. You know. Yeah, I think that it's so important because, like, as our kids go back to school, we get so busy and we just forget that, okay, fall's coming, winter's coming. We have to hurry up and get all this stuff done before it gets too cold. You know, most importantly, like you said, the gutters. Because, you know, if we don't clean it out, it gets too heavy. And, you know, we have all that debris in the gutter and it's just clogs up the system. And also the outdoor spigot, that's so important.
Right,
you
right.
know. So I had a homeowner where they had a leaking outdoor spigot. Every time they used it because they didn't winterize it, it would leak into their home and it leaks into the basement. And it caused a lot of damages, and you know it could get costly. So very good tips.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So, then you know the only thing I just want to encourage anyone out there that did buy that house without the home inspection, it's never too late. I can be of value to you.
Right. Yeah.
Through here. So. Yeah. But that's about what I have for you.
Yeah. Well, Tito, do you have anything else that you want to say to our viewers, Bill, before we close our show? How do they get a hold of you if they want to reach out to you?
Oh, okay. Well, you can. My name of my company is Inspected First of Andover. My phone number is 612-554-0805. My website is inspectedofandover.com, or my email is my name, Bill Bisick, BILLBISEK@gmail.com.
Okay. Yeah, sounds good. Thank you so much, Bill, for coming on my show. And, you know, I felt like I had so many good takeaways sitting down with you. And I also going to go home and I have a long list to do. So I'll have to share with my husband. I'm sure he's probably done a few, but time to get the kids to work.
So, thank you so much.
Yeah, so thank you so much for coming in. And folks, thanks for tuning in with us. If you guys have any questions, feel free to reach out to Bill. He's been in the business for a long time. He's an expert in home inspections. If you guys are looking to buy, you're looking to sell, Bill is the person to call. And also not just home inspections, he does chimney inspections, sewer scopes, radon testing, mold inspections. So feel free to reach out to Bill. So thanks again for tuning into the My Miller Show. Don't forget, I am a real estate broker, so if you guys have any real estate needs, feel free to reach out to me. Thanks for tuning in. This is My Miller. I'll see you guys next time.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for coming in today. Yeah. Thank you.